The first scripture reading this morning, we turn to the book of Genesis, chapter 11, 1 through 9. Now, the whole earth had one language and the same words. And as they migrated from the east, they came upon a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. They said to each other, "Come, let's make bricks and bake them thoroughly." They used brick instead of stone and tar for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let's build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches the heavens so that we can make a name for ourselves and not be scattered over the face of the whole earth." But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the mortals had made. And the Lord said, "Look, they are one people, and they have all one language, and this is only the beginning of what they'll do. Nothing that they propose to do now will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language so we'll not understand each other." So the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of all the earth, and they stopped building their city. Therefore, it shall be called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth. And from there, the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of the whole world.
We shall see you now. Amen. And we continue with the reading of Scripture as it comes to us from the book of Acts in the second chapter. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven, there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues, as of fire, appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each one of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." All thanks and praise be to God for his word. May God add to our hearing this day his blessing, that our understanding may be deeper. Amen. So as we unpack these two famous stories, stories that we all know so well, the Old Testament story of the Tower of Babel, and of course the New Testament story of the day of Pentecost, the day that we celebrate today. As we unpack these stories, I want to have you think of one phrase in particular. Language is power. Language is power. Anyone who's gone to a different nation whose language you do not know knows what that means. When you go there, you realize you've given up some power just by being there, just by being in a place where you are now dependent upon someone else who knows the language, or you're dependent upon how well you can do all kinds of signs with your hands to get somebody to understand you. And you feel out of the power loop. You not only feel out of the power loop, you are dependent upon the grace and kindness of other people for whom you need to make a request or communicate something. Have you ever had the occasion here in the United States to be in an experience with someone who doesn't know the English language and they're trying to express something and you sort of have to hang in there and try to get what they're asking you and work through it, and it can be a lot of work. But do you also recall the look in their eye, the look on their face when you connect and you've communicated without using the language? It's like, aha! And you're proud of yourself. You say, "I can do this. I can communicate with another human being without us knowing each other's language. If only you hang in there and have the patience and you have the grace of inclusivity, that I'm going to hang in there with this person until we communicate. The grace of intentional inclusion. Think about this for a minute. Jesus spoke in Aramaic. Oops. And Aramaic is one of the ancestor languages of ancient Hebrew. Aramaic is older than Hebrew. Hebrew became an offshoot of that language. Jesus spoke in Aramaic. But now think of this. The New Testament was written in Greek. Jesus and the disciples all spoke in Aramaic. And the New Testament was written in Greek. Why? Because the Greek Empire had once been so powerful that people were still throughout that former empire of Greece, which was now the Roman Empire, people were still speaking in Greek. They were also having to learn now how to speak in Latin because that was the power language of the Roman Empire. But even those in charge of the Roman Empire who spoke the power language of Latin also needed to know Greek in order to communicate throughout the empire that Rome had conquered. That's how powerful Greece had been, and was how powerful the Greek language had persisted to be. You know, nowadays, you travel the world, you go to different places, and yes, you'll be challenged because you've got to figure out how to communicate with people who don't know English, but you know what? If you've been to enough countries, one of the things you notice is that sooner or later, you're going to find somebody who knows at least a little bit of English so that you can communicate. Just as Greek was the power language of the first century in this world, so English is one of the power languages across the globe today. Language is power. Very often in the United States, we complain about those immigrants who come over and don't speak our language. And why do we complain about that? Because you see, if they don't learn English, or they're slow at learning English, and we have to communicate with them, we say, why do I have to communicate in their language? Why don't they communicate in my language? And the reason we say that is because it takes a little bit of power away from us. We no longer have power in the presence of everybody who are our neighbors. And that can threaten us in our society. In the Tower of Babel account, the power of humans with one language created a problem for God. Think about that for a minute. They said to themselves, we can now build an empire that is greater than even God because we share one language. We are one people. We are powerful unto ourselves. And that is precisely when God decided to mix up their languages. Now, why did God do that? After all, God has told us time and time again that God wants us in community. Wouldn't one language make that even more possible if the entire human race spoke one language? Isn't that what God wants anyway? Our Wednesday morning men's breakfast, we meet every Wednesday morning down at Perkins on San Carlos, and we've been reading a book by Brian McLaren. And in that book, we have touched upon many topics along the way, but this past week was on the topic of Pentecost. And McLaren says that the Spirit is multilingual. And he goes on to say, there is no unity without diversity, and there is no diversity without unity. Unity and diversity, at least in the context of the community of faith, must be in harmony. But in order to get there, in order to get to that unity and diversity in harmony, we have to work at it. We have to commit ourselves to it. We can't just depend on one human language. That makes us lazy. In a world of diversity, striving for unity, we must seek harmony as the people of God. God's idea of community simply is not ours. Because you see, our human version of all that is about power. It's about our power. We want to retain control over our culture with our language because that is power, and to be out of power is threatening. But God, in the Tower of Babel story, dismantled the human power structure. And that story forever asks us about our own in any time, place, or culture. Our power structure, the one that we humans build, is always up for question. And that is what the Tower of Babel story challenges us to understand. You know, throughout the prophets of the Old Testament, they were continually making statements about God's shaking the power structure of humanity. In Isaiah 10, we hear this: by the strength of my hand, I have removed the boundaries of the people. Like a bull, I have brought down those who sat on thrones. God is in the business of shaking up human power structures in every generation. And so this language of divine power versus human power goes from the book of Genesis to the Old Testament prophets to Jesus himself and even to the book of Acts as declared on the day of Pentecost. You know what earthly power was on the day of Pentecost? It was the point that the same language had to be spoken as the guys in charge. If you wanted to understand, you had to speak the language of the power base. And on that day of Pentecost, as those disciples broke out to start the church, the power base in language was the Aramaic that they spoke. And that's the way it always works. We want everybody on the same page before we start the project. I want to show you a quote from George Orwell. This was given in 1946, and just think about it for a minute. I think it's prophetic in some respects if you think about our times. In our time, it is broadly true that political writing is bad writing and seems to demand a lifeless, imitative style. Political dialects are all alike in that one almost never finds in them a fresh, vivid, homemade turn of speech. When one watches some tired political hack on the platform, mechanically repeating the familiar phrases, one often has a curious feeling that one is not watching a live human being, but some kind of dummy. George Orwell, 1946, folks. Powerful words. God's model was different from all that. Why? Because on the day of Pentecost, the disciples had to give up language control. What does that mean? Jesus Christ could be, still had to be, proclaimed in all those languages that the disciples learned. But the fact of the matter is, the disciples couldn't do it in their own power-based language. They had to do it in the language of everyone who showed up that day. And that made the disciples, the proclaimers of the good news of Jesus Christ, made them dependent upon the context of those who knew the language better than they did. The minute you do that, you open yourself to a brand new kind of creativity. The minute you do that, you give God room to work rather than insist on your own space. You know, in seminary, I used to wonder why on earth they made us take Hebrew and Greek before we could be ordained as Presbyterian ministers. Now, the Greek for me went pretty well. I took it for 2 years. I still have a working knowledge of it today. I'm not great, but I can work with it. By the time the Hebrew commitment came, my senior year, man, I just wanted to graduate. And I didn't care about Hebrew, and it took me 3 weeks to realize I wasn't reading it in the right direction, which is why it didn't make any sense. And I took it, and I took it pass-fail, and I passed. And then you gotta take your ordination exam on Bible in either the Greek or the Hebrew, and I chose the Greek because the Hebrew was already being lost to me. And years later, don't even ask me to look at Hebrew. I can't tell you what's there. But, and you gotta wonder, why do they make us go through this if they know darn well that most of us are gonna forget at least one of those languages throughout our career? Here's the reason. Whether I remember all the grammar and all the rules and all the vocabulary doesn't matter. What matters is that they forced me to take Old Testament texts in Hebrew, and by learning the language, I had to get inside the heads of those who wrote those things down. And even if I can't remember the language anymore, I remember the experience of getting inside those writers and understanding their context. And that's why they make you do it in seminary, because they know not everybody's going to remember the language, but you're going to remember the experience of being there in a culture and with a people you would not have known any other way. Pentecost proclaims to us that it's all about context. God could have given everybody who showed up in Jerusalem that weekend for the Jewish holiday of Pentecost. He could have given everybody the same language so they could understand what the disciples were saying, but God didn't do that. God made the disciples do the work to speak the language of the guests who had shown up. Because when you speak somebody's language, you're inside their heads, you're inside their hearts, and when you bring them the good news of Jesus Christ, you do it on their turf and not your own. And that is what Pentecost is all about. Come to my world is not Christ's intent. It's rather, let me speak to you in your language. Let me speak to you in your context. Let me accept your invitation to come into your mind and your heart and understand you better in that way. That's what it is. At times, that means we may have to literally learn someone else's language, but it doesn't have to be that way. It may also mean we just make the effort to learn someone else's context. We know what it is when everybody in the room knows how to speak English, but you're from such different cultures, you got to listen to the other. It took me 2 or 3 years when I first moved to Minnesota from Kansas to understand Scandinavian culture. It takes that long. And I didn't get it at first. But if you hang in there, you learn it. And we were all speaking the same language. Well, sort of. They had words I never understood before. But I learned them. Yeah, sure, you betcha. We can all be speaking English and not understand each other. We know that. And then you can just go into a world of different languages and realize how disconnected we really can become. Because there are power differentials. We hang on to our own icons and our own symbols. We have generational language, okay? Baby boomers don't understand everything millennials say and vice versa. Because it changes. You know, before we listen to white cultural explanations of what the phrase Black Lives Matter really mean, it's probably important that we ask an African American what they think it means. Because the white explanation won't be the same. And you won't get it. That is learning how to share language in diversity. Pentecost is clear. The first step to sharing the good news is learning another's language of life. That's about grace. It's about goodwill. It's about patience. It's about a heart for the other. It's about asking, what is the good news for those to whom God has sent me? Our version of good news may be a different language that they can't understand. It may not be relevant to their life experience. But the day of Pentecost reminds us that indeed, when we seek to do it in another's language, another's context, it will always be relevant. And it's up to us to learn that gift. Thanks be to the Spirit that teaches us. Amen.